having me leg cut off in 2013, but it's fucking happier than that shit. so yeah, thank you very much, everyone.
Yes.
Dick Richard normally plays an integral part in the show, which is that of the unicorn. Well, the unicorn mask is currently in my bath because of reasons. Halloween. And so as such, we've cobbled together a costume from things we've found in a skip. It looks nothing like a unicorn. So have fun spotting that. That's like the Where's Wally of the show. That's your little quiz. Right, so yeah, so welcome. This isn't the show, by the way. This is just me speaking. The show is also me speaking, but in a slightly different tone of voice, because that's ours, isn't it? So yeah, so this goes, some people have too many legs. I've put on 3 stone since I'm a leg off, so I've been thinking of calling it Some People Have Too Many Gregs. It is about having your leg cut off. It sounds all a bit bleak. Well, I'm sure your lives are not that precious about it, so feel free to laugh. A couple of warnings. One, there are flashing lights in the show. We've been told that the bulbs don't aggravate epileptics into dying, but I don't want to risk your life on the word of a man from Dixon's. So if you've got light irritated epilepsy, then when the warning is when I start reading Facebook statuses, then you know, do what you've got to do, put your hands over your eyes or run away, whatever. I said that, we did this in a prison, and I said run away. Actually, don't you run away either, unless you're gonna die. What else? I've written on my arm, which I thought you might not notice because of all the tattoos. What else do I need to tell you? I think that's sort of it. I normally like go, because we do this for kids, and I normally go like, hey kids, loads of swearing in it, you know, I just use swearing as punctuation. You know, hey kids, you know, if you swear too much by the age of 30, your leg falls off. But you all, right, yeah, I think we're all right. Oh, I know, no, this is important, last thing, before I wank on for an hour. There's a really bad Welsh accent in the show. I've tried, I've watched Gavin and Stacey, it's shit. So, when my voice changes, that's meant to be Welsh. Not want to go nurse, that's meant to be Glaswegian. So yeah, so just be aware of that. Right, hello. Are you alright?
Yeah.
Yeah, you got teddies. Feel free to like hug them. Nurture a relationship with them, and then I'll cruelly steal them back at the end. So if you feel a sense of loss, just apply to the Arts Council, make a show about it, you know, loss is the thing. Right! Well, I think we're ready to start. I'm gonna take my cardio. So my name's Jack Hayne, and I'm not a proper grown-up. I still don't eat my crusts, and I can't put a duvet cover on without getting stuck inside. The thing is, I've never seen the appeal. Being a grown-up seems to be mainly about Wednesdays, spreadsheets, and eating vegetables. I don't want to do that. Until now. You see, this is a bit embarrassing, but I want to impress a lad. Miles Charles Haddington. Proper grown-up. Oxford graduate. Says words like tarragon and life insurance. Grows his own herbs and thinks that's normal. And has reluctantly agreed to be my boyfriend. You see, my particular brand of flirting is a delicate balance of push-up bras and bullion. The thing is, he's not completely sold on me. Like, I'm chaos. I let slip to him that I spent the 20s in that psychiatric ward. I tried to reassure him. I told him that the last time I was there was ages ago. In fact, it was that seminal moment in British history, that summer when Jedward came into our lands. They were everywhere, they were on the telly, on magazines, and I was fucking nuts. And I thought that Jedward was a symptom of my psychosis. I thought I'd made that shit up. Regardless, them first 2 months with my eyes were anxious bliss. We went to the cinema, we went to the theatre, we went to A&E. They kept me in. I hate hospitals. They're so beefy. It's like living in a techno album that doesn't know how to dance. And the pain, I've never known pain like it. It's like learning that there's a new colour, only shite. And I don't know if it's all morphine, but every time that doctor comes, he's got a different head. I'd never learn all the names. Dr. Smith, Dr. Jones, Dr. Frankenstein. But I remember something my dad taught me when I was growing up. What you do if you don't know something? You make it up. Hello, Dr. Dre. He tells me I've got a massive cluster of blood clots in my ankle. The stuff that they can do, and none of it sounds good. But it's important to endure because it might save your legs and your life. Save your legs. Save your life. Miss Hagan, if we do this blah blah procedure, you might not die. Might not die. Might not die. I might not die. I might be immortal. Well, I've always suspected. One of them, a dirty blonde with an Irish twang, is wearing a green jumper. He grips the end of his sleeve so his feelings don't fall out and pretends to be taller. He's 17. For the past 15 minutes, he's been trying to make eyes at the girl. This pub is full of girls. Girls with long brown hair and outfits they think the boys will like, but this girl is unapologetically hair. She's 15, but she knows a thing or two. An enthusiastic name on the nightclub scene. One night she's a Ross, the next night she's rough and but tonight. She's a go-go dancer in silver boots and a black box wig. She thinks she looks gorgeous. She looks drunk. She could steal any girl's boyfriend. She's not pretty though, she's just something. Hey, green jumper, I'm not willing to wait all night for you, she lies. Before he knows it, she's up in his face. Her breath smells of baby sham and cheap cigarette. She wants to tell him he's got beautiful eyes, but instead she drunkenly drags him outside. The shock of cold, she pulls his arms around her and whispers truthfully, I've chosen you. And 9 months later, I'm born. If you're a good Catholic, you meant to name your child after a saint. So they named me after one of Charlie's angels. We were living in my dad's teenage bedroom until something miraculous happened. Liverpool decided to build a promised land called Skelmersdale. Skelmersdale. A new town with half a bus stop with a can of lager and a spliff in it. Skelmersdale, 15 miles from anything of use or interest. Skelmersdale, loads of cheap housing no other bugger will live in. Skelmersdale. Skelm. My mum sits at the dining room table with loads of tiny bits of chamois leather, which she glues together to make one big chamois leather for 12p a go. In her head, she's dancing on a podium. My dad gets a job far away. At the weekends, I count the cuts on his hands. I make him little presents, like, I don't like the nut ones in Rebels, so I suck the chocolate off. And at the weekends, I present him with a proud little pile of peanuts. The whole house reeks of super glue and hard graft. When I grow up, I want to live in a house that doesn't smell of glue. So I have a plan. When I grow up, I will be clever and find my way out. When I grow up, I will be a duck trailer. A duck trailer is someone who follows the duck footprints in the snow and finds the duck at the other end. Duck trailers do not exist. When you get sick, you get loads of attention. I'm loving it. My friends have decorated the wall behind my bed with the best headlines from the worst magazines. My toddler has a spray tan. A ghost sat my geography A level. I hide biscuits underneath my giant boobs. And my personal favourite, I run over my dog and now I walk sideways like a crab. I've made friends with the woman in the next bed. Her name's Edna, she's 73 and she looks like a threadbare tennis ball with eyes. She hates Scousers, Manx, coffee, tea, wisdom, jumble sales, swearing, toddlers, Paul Daniels, my tattoos, my hair, my face, me, and above all, nurses. I fucking love Edna. I can imagine her in leather. On the other side is Sally. Now, I can't imagine Sally in leather. She's one of them people who's kept a life in a biscuit tin. She likes gin and jam, and she lies on her side. Her eyes are big and bewildered like a cow. Nurse! 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 The nurses ignore her and this pisses me off. So, I flop over to see what she wants. She wants me to tickle her on the back. It is big and spongy and the temperature of rice pudding just at the point the skin forms. Once I've done it, she asks me to do it again. I tickle her big, expansive back 7 times and then I start ignoring her too. When I was 3, I was obsessed with the rain dance. And then my mum told me that there's another one called the sun dance, which is exactly the same, only silent. My next obsession was with Brookside. If you're too young to remember Brookside, I think there's people over. No, sorry, I just decided you weren't. Maybe you are. Let's go with that, because that's less insulting, isn't it? If you don't know what Brookside is, anyone, it was like a Scouse Coronation Street, but with more lesbians and patios. And my parents took me to the set of Brookside with made up, and then years later I found out that you can't even go to the set of Brookside. My parents had just taken me to a cul-de-sac and pointed at it and called it Brookside. The third obsession was my hamster, and inevitably it died. It was the first time I'd encountered death. I was very worried. I asked my mum, is this going to happen to me? Am I going to die? And my mum said, no. My mum said that my entire family are immortal because we've been chosen especially by Paul Daniels. Now, parents lie. They have to. Parents lie, and the dead good are making a Sunday roast while having a nervous breakdown on the sly. Now, my parents were dead ordinary, but sort of bonkers from having kids, too young, too poor, and too scared. So I was brought up on love, lies, spam, optimism, and imagination. But with me, it's a little bit more pronounced because I've honestly got this thing wrong with my eyes that is called FUP syndrome. They beeped that out on a BBC radio show about disability. It means that like the glare from lights is shed loads. I'm in the wrong game at the moment. I can't see for shit. And it's sort of like colourful at the edges. Am I a cross between a mogwai and a pensioner? And this one time, I was on a rail replacement bus going from Wigan to Manchester, living the dream. And it was night time. And outside, there was one of them, you know, them beautiful big moons when the moon appears bigger than usual, like a harvest moon. And all the people on this bus, they weren't looking at it, they were just like pissing about on the phones, and it was annoying me. And I have like these sort of like happy panic attacks, right? You know, when I see something that I think is beautiful or is important. The first time I had one was when I was a little toddler, and it was the first time I saw a tombola. So I was out on this, and I got everyone on this coach to look at this beautiful harvest moon, and it was a clock on the side of the chair. Another time, I was 17, and I had one of them like groups of mates, you know, where they all ate each other. And I was like the stupid little mascot who said the daft things. I was like Phoebe from Friends, but with less respect. And I saw on the ground a stunningly beautiful seashell. And they were all over here being teenagers, snobbing each other with mouths full of cheap sighs and resentment. And I dragged them away from that to look at this. And then I realized that it wasn't a stunningly beautiful seashell. It was the product of FUP syndrome and optimism. It was a pile of sick. And I've been encouraging my friends to prod vomit. Now, I went home that night, I was gutted, and I decided that I was 17, it was time to grow up. It was nearly university, so I got a curtain bag and I put into it all teddies and dolls and childhood things. And in my head, I put into it optimism and imagination. I decided that was that. I was a grown up, I was going to be a cynic. No more duck trailing. The ducks can look after themselves. Lasers, and I had to lay back on a metal table and stay very still. and the pain. A bit through my tongue and my mouth fills with blood. And I freaked out. And what I wanted to happen was for my dad to come and just whisk me off and to make it all better, but I knew that couldn't happen. So, I made a decision in my head that all of it, no matter how it turns out, I'd somehow make it into a good thing. I'd make it the making of me. This was my opportunity to finally grow up. Otherwise, it was just too shit. If I could stay in that moment where the tennis ball reaches its height and takes a breath before remembering to fall. In that moment, safety smells like mustiness and play-doh. And I can pretend that I'm gonna wake up as a little mouse curled up in a tramp's pocket. Or that I'm 7. And I still have that childhood sense of belonging long before I knew I could even get lost. And I'm laid on the couch with my dad and we're watching our favourite programme, which was Hello Hello, which was set in the war. But I just thought it was a programme about a load of nice people running a cafe. I didn't notice the war. Me and my dad were best friends then, but then I kept getting older. I couldn't help it. I started wearing lipstick and shouting. And then I went away to university. In scam, everyone's pretty much exactly the same. There's no class system, there's just people with slightly nicer shoes. So when I went to university, it was really weird to find out that other people had lived differently to how I had. I had thought that everyone lived in a council flat because doesn't the council own buildings? Like it owns streets and fields and air, and sometimes they'll come and paint all the doors a shit colour, or they'll put a new window in for Mary Kenny, who never misses mass, who's always having a window put through because she doesn't give the wall back. That's the way the world works. But suddenly it wasn't. Started sitting in corners. Started shutting up. Remember things I never knew remembered. Am I stupid? Skem Library has pop-up books. The library here doesn't know how to laugh. Decided to lose my accent, leave it on the bus. Go to visit my parents and the house smells wrong. I see my dad crying for the first time. He's crying from the pain in his foot. I don't like it, so I go back to university and his foot goes black. And then you have to cut it off. And then he has a stroke. And then he just dies. Decide to cope by not coping. Decide to just never think about him again. And that's what I do. Except for the annual bittersweet stab through the heart at Christmas, when shopping and noticing good presents for him. He used to tell me stories in primary colours because, well, I was young and they were long ago. His hands ground in dirt filled the gaps when he didn't know or have the breath for words. I was meant to retell these stories when I was older. I was meant to be an author, or a spaceman, or something. The stories were set in Liverpool, and there was a gang life in the Beano, and then a school or something. I can't remember anymore. Facebook statuses. August the 1st. Edna's off her tits on morphine. She's just told me that in the war, the women put gravy on their legs and the dogs licked it off. August 13th. I'm copying Miles's coping methods. He says things like, you live and learn, onwards and upwards. You can only piss with the cock you've got. August 28th. Dr. Quinn, medicine woman, comes and tells me that there's only one thing they can do now before cutting it off. And you will not believe what it is. To get rid of all the bacteria, they want to put maggots on it. Dirty bastards. And the maggots are coming from Wales. I can imagine them all on the National Express with the little packed lunches made up to be coming to Manchester. September 12th. There's a nurse here whose actual name is Sweetie, which is ironic because she's a bellend. September 20th. Dr. Zeus came today and told me that the Welsh maggots have let me down. In order to save my life, they're going to amputate my leg. But don't worry, it'll be okay. Barbara. It's not our fault. I ate as much of that mini pot as I could get down me. We shouldn't have had those sandwiches on the coach. I do feel sorry for her, love. Imagine wandering around the world with one leg. What will become of her? She is a bit of a weirdo, though. She might carry it off. I know. She could be a Paralympian. So, three things start happening when you've had your leg put off. Number one, everyone tells you that you could be a Paralympian. Aye, mate, and you could be an Olympian, couldn't you? Number two, you get called brave for everything, every 5 minutes, just for eating a Twix, for not falling over, for falling over, and it's sort of patronising, you know, it's like, you know, oh, well done. Like, what's the alternative? You know, you're just continuing to live your life. In disabled community, it's inspiration point, it's seen as dead bad. I can see their point, however, I quite like compliments. So I think my position on the matter is, how dare you call me brave, but thanks for noticing I am rather than. The third thing is that everyone asks you if it hurts to have your leg cut off. I use all the powers of metaphor and poetry to sum up the specific pain, and it's this. You know when you stub your toe? Well, fuck off. My friends these days aren't the type who will hate each other. Everyone I know now is Phoebe from Friends. They're surrounded my bed, and at one point they get upset and they know what to do. They launch into an off-key rendition of the theme tune to One Foot in the Grave. Someone's made me a pirate costume. Someone's baked me a batch of gingerbread men with the right leg missing. I'm okay. Somehow, it's suiting me. And then, the pain comes back in the leg that isn't there anymore. And this nurse with a hen party for a face. Tells me about phantom pain. Your leg is gone, but your brain doesn't know that, so the pain stays. I ask her how long that's gonna last, because I can't be dealing with that bullshit, and she says, oh, it'll last for the rest of your life. Not fair. It's the type of pain that makes it hard to be nice. So, my brain can't remember my dad, but I can remember pain in a leg that I can't even use. For a while, I don't cope. I just throw the towel in. But Miles keeps coming to visit me, even though I'm being a total bitch to him. I used to think that intimacy looked like a dozen red roses and Richard Curtis films, and I thought, I don't want that because I'm not Bridget Friggin Jones. But sometimes it can look like a room you've been in for months that doesn't want to be a room anymore, that smells of TCP and disabled cliche. For his sake, I tell myself, you live and learn, onwards and upwards. You can only piss with the cock you've got. The cock I've got is imagination, optimism, and a pen and paper. So, I start writing certificates for anyone, for anything that's good. I give one to a nurse who's got a pretty ear. one to a doctor who gives me more time than I know he's really got. One for a man for looking really, really Welsh. As things get harder, I give them to people for doing unnecessary eye contact or for having odd socks or asymmetrical faces. When things get really hard, I give them to people for having a head. I made one for Edna for how well she copes with hardship and she laughs at me. You don't know the art of it, love. I tell her that I love her and she laughs again. You haven't learned love yet, you chicken. I tell her that I'm trying to be a proper grown-up and she teaches me to iron using a shoe. I've started to crave outdoors. I can smell it on people's skin when they come to visit. I want to leave, but they don't want me to because the wound from the operation isn't healing. If it doesn't heal, then they're going to have to cut more off. And then if that doesn't heal, more and what until I'm just a head. I don't ask because I don't want to know. I need to have it checked every 3 days. I need to keep an eye on it. I'm worried. However, I was brought up by Scouse hecklers. I've got the gift of the gab and I've got a massive cob on, so they agree to let me leave. On the way out of the hospital, they give me a list of things to avoid. One of them is falling over. Dead, weird. His posters are all in frames. He drinks wine out of wine glasses. I can't believe how comfortable houses are. In physio, I stand up for the first time in 5 months. It hurts all over and feels like flying. I never thought I'd say this, but I've grown sick of being at the eyeline of people's arses. One day I get up and there's all little bits of paper all over the floor. I pick one up and on it, drawn in biro, is a duck footprint. I follow them and at the end is this. A real life duck with a note on its belly that says, Jackie Hagan, stop trying to impress me. I was impressed from the start. Bridget Jones at your art house. I'm worried that I've stressed my mum out with all of this. All mums want is for you to be safe, and I haven't been for ages in the same way that my dad wasn't. So I text her, just saying, I love you, I hope you're okay. And this is what she replies. You know my mate Sue has got a gastric band? Yeah. Well, last week she caught a virus off the kids and got diarrhea. And do you know where the poo came out? Dot. 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 Her mouth. Lol. Thanks, Mum. I've realised that I might not be as stupid as university taught me that I am. I'm teaching Miles things in, an Oxford graduate of me from SCEP. Things like, 1. Don't cut off your face to spite someone else's face. 2. Don't cut off your face. A ball sweet pause in someone else's mouth doesn't necessarily mean it's time for you to speak. 4. You're probably not as ugly as you think you are. You are a generous buffet of crisps. 5. The minimum fill line on a kettle is real. Six, don't remain to fumble on people, the wet attitude points of punchlines. People can fly when you don't make them feel self-conscious about it. Seven, romanticize the repetitive clunk. Eight, give your pets a heroic aura. Nine, I come from a town where the barmaids have tits and the fellas are homophobic, but in a nice way. Your weirs and your shorts and your mat on me and your gay body and your dad and he was witty and so are you. You're alright, you love ya. Weird hair. Ten. If you're working class, you inherit anger. If you're middle class, you inherit manners and a house. Unless you don't. 11. The fight for sexual equality is not between men and women. It's between people and dickheads. 12. No one looks like Kate Moss, including Kate Moss. 13. Unsolicited advice can make you sound like a dick. I don't think I'm gonna be a normal girlfriend. I don't have long brown hair and outfits I think the boys will like. I'm not pretty, I'm just something. Unapologetically me. I don't know how to do love, I don't know how to do life, and I still can't put a duvet cover on without getting stuck inside. But I remember something my dad taught me when I was growing up. What you do if you don't know something? You make it up. So on March 12th, 2014, the nurse comes and tells me that your stump is a funny shape. But that's just because it's healed weird. It's healed. That means I haven't got to have anything else amputated. Then she asks me, do you want to look at it? No, I'm alright, so I've just had my tea. And then she leaves me alone with it. Alright, mate. What are we gonna call you? Yeah, well, hey, I can't be doing it with their words. It's minging, isn't it? How about we call you a John instead? Oh shit, no, actually, that's the elephant man's name, isn't it? Please, and hell, no offence. How about Bert? Birds don't have to be pretty. Birds eat with their hands. Birds wear a flat cap. Birds call a spade a spade. Or call a stump a stump. Stump. Minging word. Absurd. Really fitting, actually. So, should we take a look at you then? Oh my god. Oh, it's proper minging. You know the blondes went out of birds with a feather? It looks like a miserable gob. Cut eyes it away forever. That's what you do with, you know, ugly stuff, stuff that people might judge you on. Could do that. Or... Or could invent stump puppetry. Guys, do you like the show so far? Bit fucking weird, isn't it? Bit weird that that's the dad voice that you hey, Miles, I've got something to show you. Alright, Miles. I'm not gonna have anything else amputated. What I do is think of things in my head 24/7 that I'm grateful for. Scousers, Manx, coffee, tea, wisdom, jumble sales, swear, toddlers, my tattoos, my hair, my face, me, and above all, nurses. I couldn't bring myself to be grateful for Paul Daniels. The end. Thank you very much.